So let's continue with the first plenary of this year's policy dialogue. The state of democracy in 2021 will reflect on the current state of democracy worldwide and those key challenges democracies will have to confront to guarantee their survival, and will try to identify key elements for a new global agenda for democracy that can deliver and restore the confidence of the people it serves. Well, before we meet our live panel guests, it's my great pleasure to give the floor to the Minister of Foreign Affairs, European Union and Cooperation of Spain for our opening remarks, Minister José Manuel Albares.
I would like to thank El Club de Madrid for this kind invitation to take part in this plenary session devoted to the state of democracy in 2021. We are here to face the global erosion of democracy and to respond to its contemporary challenges. This debate is very timely. Since the end of the Cold War, throughout three decades, the world has experienced a regular improvement of the number of democracies. In 2019, more than half of the countries in the world were democratic, and 57% of the world's population live in some form of democracy, compared to 36% in 1975. It was a time for democratic optimism. In recent times, democracy has continued to expand its global reach while experiencing a significant decline in quality. New democracies were often weak and fragile, and older ones struggled to guarantee sustainable economic and social developments in a very difficult international environment. More people today live in democratic society. There is globally more gender equality in politics. Elections are now the norm rather than the exceptions. And institutions are more representative and accountable than ever before. However, it is also clear that democracy seems to be at stake, and we need to identify key elements to restore the confidence of our citizens. Among the domestic causes of this deterioration, we might identify the crisis of representation of political parties and the rise of extremism and populism, shrinking political space for civil society, corruption, and general dissatisfaction among citizens. Global threats such as climate change, economic recovery challenges, or global insecurity also affect the quality of our democracies. In this context, the COVID-19 pandemic has put a halt to some of the processes of democratic reform while accelerating processes of democratic backsliding. We have witnessed examples of concentration of power in the executive or the lack of adequate scrutiny when enforcing states of emergency. Freedom of expression and movement, freedom of the press, and personal integrity and security were among the most affected human rights. Spain has the experience of an exemplary democratic transition after 40 years of dictatorship and authoritarianism. We are firmly convinced that democracy is the best political system to realize the aspiration for freedom, equality, dignity, and peace of our citizenship. We see the common values of inclusion, tolerance, freedom, justice, solidarity, and non-discrimination with our partners of the European Union. These core values are anchored under the pillars of our devotion to democratic elections, the rule of law, and the respect and promotion of human rights. From an international perspective, we are convinced that the reinforced multilateralism is key to overcome nationalist sentiments and the lack of global leadership. The challenges to democracies are multidimensional and far-reaching. They're not limited to a single region or any specific type of democracy. Promoting independent democratic institutions and strengthening the rule of law, combating corruption, and reinforcing democratic practices and the respect of human rights will be of paramount importance in this exercise. In that sense, we very much welcome the upcoming Summit for Democracy to be held next December, as well as the different initiatives, including those of El Club de Madrid. We are ready to contribute to them in collaboration with governments, international organizations, civil society, think tanks, and the private sector. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Minister. Your excellent contributions about the young democracies here in Europe are a great starting point for this plenary, and I will be your facilitator for this coming session. So I'm delighted to be able to introduce our panelists. Gordon Brown was the Prime Minister of the United Kingdom from 2007 to 2010, and he is, of course, a member of the Club de Madrid. Hello, Gordon Brown. Ernesto Zedillo was President of Mexico from 1994 to 2000, and he is also a member of the Club de Madrid. Good afternoon. Laura Chinchilla was the President of Costa Rica from 2010 to 2014, and she is a Vice President of the Club de Madrid. Good afternoon. And finally, Michael Abramovitz is the President of Freedom House, and welcome to you too, Michael. Panel, thank you very much for joining us. I'm going to begin by asking all of you a fairly general question. When you look across the globe at the state of democracy now, what issues should concern us the most? Gordon Brown, let me start with you.
Well, I should maybe start with Churchill because he's been mentioned already. You know, Churchill was an amazing figure because he said he had a resolution never to drink alcohol before lunch, and then he changed it that he would never drink alcohol before breakfast. But he also said, and this is related to the comment that was quoted, that democracy was the worst form of government except for all others. He also said that when facing crises in the 1930s, leaders, he said, were resolved to be irresolute, adamant for drift, solid for fluidity, and all-powerful for impotence. And I think we've got to face up to facts that we're dealing with climate change, a pandemic, an economic crisis, problems of proliferation in weapons, and many others like cybersecurity. And these are global problems that need global solutions. In other words, people need to work together to solve these problems. And if we fail to do so, then democracy itself becomes in disrepute. And I would want to suggest that when we're talking about restrictions on freedom of speech, when we're talking about the concentration of power, when we're talking about corruption, when we're talking about all the ills that in speeches the president of Costa Rica and José Manuel referred to, when we're talking about that, the root cause, it seems to me, that we cannot ignore is that while we can complain about the danger of a surveillance state and all that, and that's very important as a threat to democracy, what we're facing is political nationalism, which is now the dominant ideology of the age. It's not an economic philosophy, it's political nationalism, this idea of us versus them, that if I win, you lose. And it's led to America first, it's led to China first, it's led to India first, it's led to Japan first, Russia first, you can go right across the world. And the difference between patriotism, if you like, and that's the love of your country, and we all love our countries, our history, our traditions, and nationalism, is that political nationalism is an us versus them ideology. And as long as you have this us versus them ideology, then nationalism takes the form not just of protectionism and not just of great power competition, which we're seeing at the moment, but it leads to authoritarian populism. And we are seeing that expressed in so many different parts of the world today, and we have now got to address it. And it needs a moral effort. It needs us to be absolutely clear that we'll eliminate all forms of discrimination because these are the roots of nationalism, inequality, exploitation, discrimination. But it also means that we've got to practice cooperation, ensure it works, defend the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and in the European Union, the European Union's conditions that you've got to be democracies to be members of the European Union. And if we can do all these things, if we can show that government can work to solve problems, then I believe we can build a better future. But let's not ignore the reality around us that when global problems need global solutions, we are not showing individual populations in particular countries that that is happening. and we're allowing populist nationalists, and I could give many illustrations, but this is not the right time when it's an opening statement to do so, populist nationalists who practice authoritarian politics to close down the press, to restrict freedom of speech, to concentrate power in their own hands, to practice corruption, and they use as their justification that they're simply standing up for their nation state against all others. We've got to take nationalism head on.
Gordon Brown, thank you very much. Ernesto Zedillo, I'd like to ask you the same question. Looking across the globe at the state of democracy, what issues are concerning you the most currently?
Well, first, I am very pleased to be part of this conference. And let me start by emphasizing a negative note that I have already heard. And that is that our expectations about the state of democracy in the world, but I would say in certain regions of the world, are perhaps more negative than they were 20 years ago when the Club of Madrid was being founded. And that is indeed, sadly, the case of my own region, the case of Latin America. Although we continue to be shown, as it was already the case 20 years ago, as a region in which democracy is the rule and not the exception. Nevertheless, I think what Minister Albares said in a very subtle way, that the quality of democracy is decreasing in some parts of the world. I think I am tempted to say quite clearly that the quality of democracy in Latin America is declining very rapidly. And we are moving in a direction in which probably at some point we will have to question whether democracy is really the rule and not the exception in our region. And this is very concerning indeed, because it took many years to get rid of autocratic governments in Latin America that brought very terrible results for our societies and our economies and our political liberties. And now we are feeling that we are going back in history, because we are seeing concentration of power, we are seeing undermining of institutions, we are seeing the erosion of the checks and balances that were built over a number of years. We are seeing attacks from the part of the executive branch of governments to the judiciary and sometimes to congresses. And certainly we are seeing over and over again attempts to limit individual freedoms, all of which had been addressed in our movement towards democracy in our region. We are also seeing, and this is very concerning, in some countries, a systematic attack against institutions in charge of organizing and deciding by means of the universal vote the results of elections. So that is my big concern. And the big irony is that the leaders who are leading this movement of regression in democracy in Latin America very frequently are individuals who at some point in their past very much belong to the old regimes, the regimes that kept us with governments, autocratics, and authoritarians. And suddenly they transformed themselves. They used the democratic movement to advance their political objectives. People believed them, that they had changed their minds. And now that they are in power, thanks to the democracy that was built over several generations, they are now in this movement to undermine and destroy our democracies. So this, I think, unfortunately, is happening in other parts of the world. They use democracy to achieve power, And then they use that power to undermine democracy. And this is bad by itself, but it's also bad because it will be consequential. I think in Latin America, it means that we will have another lost decade of economic growth, and we will have a deterioration in the basic social indicators. That is to say, income distribution is deteriorating again and will further deteriorate within the next few years. And we have lost a good tranche in what we had won in our fight against poverty.
Thank you very much. Laura Cinciglia, some common themes already emerging in what we've heard from Gordon Brown and Ernesto Zedillo there. Do you want to pick up? Tell us a bit about the global trends in democracy that are concerning you the most right now.
Well, thank you very much, Jamie. It is a pleasure for me to be part of this panel. Probably I will repeat some of the concepts, but I think it is very important to underline many of the concerns that we share. I consider the current state of democracy as very fragile, and basically due to the convergence of at least three factors of concern. The first is the shortcomings that democracies are experiencing to effectively address citizens' demands and growing expectations, and also to respond to some critical structural challenges. The second is the way that public debate is being shaped by digital technologies and social media. And the third is the growth of populism and autocratic leaders and their actions to gradually undermine democracy. And let me refer to all of them briefly. Concerning the first issue, democracies around the world are under great pressure to deliver better living conditions for citizens and to respond to greater expectations. Those demands have grown as a consequence of the pandemic. Democracies are also under great pressure to address monumental structural challenges such as climate change, the technological revolution, inequalities, all of which have exacerbated feelings of uncertainty and insecurity among people. So democracies are currently dealing with pressing daily issues and expectations. And we must be very clear that there is a very important question here, and that is, how can we deal with this complexity inherent to democracy while also delivering results so that citizens don't lose confidence in it. The second factor that I mentioned is the public debate on social media. Let me say that although there are tremendous opportunities in harnessing digital technologies to encourage more participation, scrutiny, and citizens' influence on decision-making processes, there are also warnings in terms of the digital technologies and social media entailing harmful effects for democracy if manipulated or unregulated. So, you know, we know that fake news is as old as news and hate speech is as old as speech, but what these technologies have made is to exacerbate this kind of problems. And finally, the third factor I mentioned is the role of a new generation of autocrats that are undermining democracy. A worrying and increasingly trend in both developed and developing democracies is the process of gradual and progressive deterioration of the rule of law, marked by attacks on judicial independence, electoral authorities, and media integrity, and by disregard for constitutional checks and balance. So this deterioration is worrisome, not only because it entails undermining the rules and institutions that prevent the concentration and exercise of absolute power, but also because it shows how the way we are dealing, which is very poorly, with the complexities facing democracies that I already mentioned. So just to finalize, instead of innovating in the process of democratic decision-making to make them more participatory and inclusive, we seems to be, trying to put more power in the hand of those strong men, and that is undoubtedly a direct path to authoritarian rule and also to more instability and more discontent.
Thank you so much, Laura. Michael, before we get into the actual discussion, let me have you have the floor for your global overview of the greatest challenges to democracy as you see it. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much, and thank you to the Club de Madrid for including me. And thank you. It's really an honor to be on this panel with such distinguished world leaders. If I may play against type for a minute, and we are obviously quite concerned about the state of democracy in around the world at Freedom House, but I would just make two points of optimism, if I may. I think that this is a supply problem, not a demand problem. And by that, I mean, I have been quite struck over the last several years about the protests in places like Hong Kong, in Myanmar, in Belarus, in Sudan, where the people of these countries are demanding human rights, democracy, freedom, and even under incredibly repressive situations in certain countries. And while sadly their governments have not responded appropriately to that demand, I think we have to remind ourselves that the basic goal of the human heart is freedom. So I think that's number one. And I think the second point of optimism I would make, I was quite struck recently by some of the reactions to the release of the Pandora Papers. I think that as former Prime Minister Brown said, you know, it's incumbent upon democracies to deliver. It's also incumbent upon autocracies to deliver. And I believe firmly that corruption is the Achilles heel for many of these countries. And I think the idea that they are immune from the same forces that are existent in democracies is not right. So that said, I will say that we are quite concerned at Freedom House about the general state of things, as the other panelists mentioned. By now, many of you are probably aware of the basic Freedom House finding that every year for the past 15 years, there has been a decline in democracy. So that means that every year, more countries are declining in terms of their respect for political rights and civil liberties and having improvements. And I think one number from our most recent report, Freedom in the World 2021, is really, I think, eye-popping to me. And that is the fact that less than 20% of the world population now live in a country that Freedom House deems fully free. As you know, we group countries into free, partly free, and not free. And that number, that percentage of the world's population that are living in countries that are less than fully free, that's the lowest number since 1995. And so that gives you a real sense of the kind of hole that we've dug ourselves in. I think that one issue that I wanted to flag that I am deeply concerned about as a former journalist is the state of press freedom and freedom of expression around the world. As some of you may know, with respect to freedom in the world, we look at about 24 different indicators of the health of democracy. And freedom of expression and belief is the only category that has experienced a decline every year for the last 15 years. And average scores for freedom of expression and belief were down down 9% compared to 15 years ago. And media freedom has fallen by nearly 13%. And what's very sad to me is that you're seeing violent attacks on journalists. You are seeing economic pressure brought by governments to try to drive independent voices of journalism out of business. And you see the situation with disinformation and the inability to, control the efforts by authoritarian forces to really undermine democracy through disinformation. So we are very concerned. I think one point that I would make is that our data strongly suggests that once a country goes down the road to autocracy, it is very, very hard to change course. The decline of independent media, the repression of civil society, and the restrictions on civil liberties just get worse. So we really have our work cut out for us. There are obviously some exceptions to this general decline. As the president of Costa Rica mentioned in his opening remarks, that's a very positive symbol in our own hemisphere. But a number of the countries that we thought were really going to be democratic openings just a few years ago, Ethiopia, Myanmar, Tunisia, and now with the return of the Taliban in Afghanistan, it's really a pretty grim picture out there. So thank you again for letting me be with you.
Michael, thanks very much indeed. And great to hear the shout out for freedom of the press issues. Obviously a huge concern to us and the BBC and other broadcasters. We've seen our own Moscow correspondent Sarah Rainsford effectively deported just in the last 6 weeks or so. So it's really top of the mind for us. Gordon Brown, if I could just go back to you. So you heard Michael allude to the crisis in leadership for American democracy, which I might return to in a minute. But starting a little closer to home, if we look across the European Union, we see probably a deteriorating situation in several countries that are giving cause for concern right now, actually within the European Union itself. What are your thoughts on those countries in particular?
Well, I've been very sad to witness what's happened, first of all, in Hungary and then in Poland. In Hungary, Orban has managed to make immigration an issue, even although Hungary has got the least percentage of immigrants. Indeed, someone said that there were more anti-immigrant parties now in Hungary than there are immigrants. But he has exploited this issue to present himself as an authoritarian leader who will take on outsiders, who will take on adversaries. And on that basis, he has won power. Now, just as Michael said, there's resistance in many other countries. There is resistance now emerging in Hungary. But the problem is that he is exploiting popular sentiment in a tribal way. He's creating enemies where they don't exist. He is at the same time building resentments, which are imaginary rather than real. And he's been able to justify closing down much of civil society, restrictions on the press, restrictions on the courts, and restrictions on other parties. And many believe that there is a great deal of corruption that is waiting to be exposed in Hungary. Now, this is at the heart of Europe. And this is most worrying because of the ideals of the European Union. And we're now seeing a conflict, of course, between the Polish government and the European Union, with Polish courts that some people believe have been packed by the government, saying that Poland need not work under the constitution of the European Union. Now, I do put this back to nationalism. And the reason I do is I saw the Brexit debate in Britain, which created anti-immigrant feelings, a tribalism, a sort of xenophobia and isolationism that was both unfortunate for Britain, but also bad for relations with other countries. And I can see how leaders can continue to exploit that to justify all these restrictions. So we've got to stand up to it. But unless you identify what the real problem is, then you'll not be able to tackle it. And I do think we should be saying that we stand up for the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And I do think we should be saying we'll have no truck with nationalism in the form that it's taking. And until we say that, I think people will not understand exactly what we are trying to protest about and why we are saying that democracy is under threat. So we've got to understand the economic and social roots of what's happening. We've got to understand the way that this retreat on democracy is being expressed, and we've got to take it head on.
Thank you very much. Michael Abramovich, let me return to you very directly on the crisis in American leadership, and then I'm going to ask Ernesto and Laura also to respond. You know, I was in Washington just after January the 6th and personally found it profoundly shocking to see those sights of the wanted posters on bus stops in Washington, D.C., of the suspects from the January the 6th insurrection at the Capitol. It was an event that shocked people across the democratic world, and I'm sure you felt the same. But you, could you take head on the point that it is fundamentally eroded confidence in American democratic leadership? And we've heard mention of President Biden's summit of the democracies, and you might wish to speak to that. But in principle, since we last met, the principle of American democratic leadership has been fatally undermined, has it not?
I would take the word fatally out of there.
Okay.
There's no question that American leadership has been undermined, but I'm a great optimist about my country, and I don't really mean to be Pollyannish. Let me just say, first of all, there is no question that, like many other democracies around the world, the United States has been in for a bit of a bad run over the last 10 to 15 years. And I would say, by the way, that we should acknowledge that problems in the United States did not start in the last administration and have not ended with the end of the last administration. I think issues of equal justice, issues of the ability of our government to deliver on what people on the problems of people, these are problems that endure. But I'm very optimistic in the long term about America, because I do think that we have an amazing constitution, an amazing ability to rebound from troubles. And I think that President Biden has clearly recognized that we have a problem. And we are very much looking forward at Freedom House, certainly, to the Summit for Democracy. I think one point that I would make is that every country that comes to that summit, and I believe they're planning to invite 100 democracies to the summit, that every country, including the United States, we believe should be making a commitment, some kind of a commitment of things that they will do over the next several years to strengthen their own democracy. No one's alone in this. We all have to be together in this. It can be something to do with the press. It can be something to do with fighting corruption. It can be something to do with protecting equal rights for all people under law. But every country has to take this seriously. It's not time for pointing fingers at others. And I do think, from my understanding of the administration, that they are planning to come to the summit with some specific deliverables. And so I think they will then be able to be judged on what they say, but not only on what they say, on whether they actually deliver on those commitments. That's what's really important.
Much. Anessa de Zedillo, may I ask you to respond to this? Does the strength of democracy in Central America depend to a large extent on a beacon, an example in the United States itself, or is it a regional question that can be dealt with at a regional level by you and other governments in Central America? Please, Ernesto Zedillo, I don't have your sound on. Would you like to just retry with the mute?
Yeah, okay, yes. Well, I cannot really speak for Central America because we have a better representative from Central America in this panel, President Chinchilla. Only a portion of Mexico belongs to Central America. But I believe that whatever countries don't do for themselves cannot be done by external forces or influences. I think citizens in Central America, in Latin America, have to take their own responsibility for protecting their own democracy. And frankly, and this I say as a person who spends most of my professional time in the United States. I am a professor at an American university, so I have the opportunity to follow events in this country, in the United States. So I say this as a friend and in a very respectful way, and I say this to the friends in the Biden administration. I think they have underestimated the damage that U.S. leadership has endured in recent years. The American administration should understand that not because they have a different president than the one they had the previous 4 years, a fact that I celebrate to see not the same person that was there before, and I am pleased that this has happened. But I think they are thinking that just because the president has changed, now there will be automatically an element of a strong leadership again from the part of the United States. And that definitely is not the case, and certainly not in the case of democracy, because unfortunately events that we have seen over the last 5 years in the United States don't make of this country, and I say this with regret, with pain, is not really an example of democracy for the world. So I will tell my friends in the U.S. administration that they should be more careful about claiming a leadership that really has to be gained very carefully, very systematically. And one thing that I think has to do a lot with what my dear friend Gordon Brown has been doing, for many years actually, because I have been following Gordon on this subject for many years since he was, in the opposition and then as Chancellor of the Exchequer. And he has been an authentic proponent of multilateralism. And in the last 2 years, he has been admirable, you know, putting a big fight to mobilize the international community in support of the multilateral institutions to confront the big challenges that I would say humanity at large are confronting. But I would say that so far, in many key aspects, the Biden administration is not living up to the expectations that at least people like me will have. So I will tell my friends, be careful in not exaggerating the influence and the leadership that at this point the U.S. has. You have to work hard and you have to deliver real actions and real examples to reclaim that leadership that once you had.
Thank you. And Laura Cecilia, I must ask you the same question. From that Central American perspective, does the recent crisis in U.S. democratic leadership affect the appeal of democracy in the region, or is it something that you can deal with on a regional level?
Yes. Well, first, excuse me, because it seems to be that I am having trouble with my my connectivity. Although, you know, I am in Spain right now, I'm traveling and it seems to be that the problem is with the hotel I am. The first thing we should say about Latin America is that few regions in the world embrace the democratic creed as enthusiastically as Latin America did during the third wave of democratization. And also that beyond internal reforms that we implemented, also, as a region, we promoted very relevant instruments as the so-called the Inter-American Democratic Charter, approved more than 20 years ago, in fact. Yet, despite this exceptional progress that we achieved as a region, in just this last decade, the Latin America has lost 4 democracies, Haiti and Honduras, which are considered hybrid regimes, and Nicaragua and Venezuela. And probably you already know that in just 10 days, we will have another setback in Nicaragua when they will elect, I mean, the government will organize a massive fraud in order to stay in power. So here, I would say that this not only has to do with the some attitudes that we have seen in the United States from some of its leaders, but because we are showing very concerning trends in Latin America, as Ernesto already mentioned. And I would like to highlight two important trends in Latin America right now, and of course in Central America. The first is that, and that is also general, the avenues to democratic backsliding are less visible than before in certain way, but the instruments and the mechanisms to respond to these situations are very inefficient. So today, more than coups or electoral frauds, the most serious threat to democracy come from the weakening of the rule of law by the so-called strong leaders or caudillos. So while the region doesn't wake up every day with more autocracies within its border, it certainly wakes up every day with democracies of low quality. And that is happening all around the region. So without disregarding the regional mechanisms that we establish to respond to sounding cases of democratic collapse, Latin America must place greater emphasis on the process of gradual and progressive democratic deterioration. Because if we continue operating under the logic that everything is fine until everything is wrong, we will continue carrying the risk that we are seeing right now in Nicaragua. When we decide to act collectively through, for example, the Organization of American States, it is already too late. So that is one of the trends that we have to put attention in Central America, but in Latin America general. And the second one is that right now in Latin America, you can find that traditional and fresh approaches to democracy are both clashing but coexisting at the same time. And so there are opportunities, there are risks, but there are also opportunities to, for example, take some decisions, promote some reforms based on what people are basically saying, not only through the polls, but also in the streets. They are demanding more participation and a stronger voice in public agenda. So that means that at the same time that we have to do something with our traditional representative institutions like parliaments and the political parties, at the same time, we should bring some fresh ideas about how to renew some of the instruments of a more kind of participatory democracy in the way that probably Chile is approaching to resolve their its institutional problems.
Thank you very much indeed. Laura, I will thank you for mentioning Nicaragua, because of course we're going to hear at the close of today's session from Sergio Ramirez, the former vice president of Nicaragua. So an important voice to be heard in this debate. And thank you for mentioning that. I'll move on from the question of the United States in just a moment. I think we should talk about the strongman model. But before we do, Gordon Brown, I'd just like to let you have your say briefly on this question. You're someone who spent a lot of time in the United States, both working in that multilateral framework, as has been mentioned, but I know it's a country you holidayed in and have a deep affection for. What's your take? Are you with Michael Abramovitz that this is a kind of a blip and that the US can turn back from the brink, as it were?
I think we're at a transition point for America. You know, it used to be said of Britain, we'd lost an empire and not found a role. And I think that was true, that Britain was not sure about its position in the world. And I think what's happened in America is that for 30 years since the end of the Cold War, America has been able to act unilaterally as if it was a unipolar era. And now it is finding it difficult trying to act unilaterally when we're in a multipolar era. So you can see what happened over Afghanistan, the lack of consultation, yet there were 35 different countries who had been partners in Afghanistan, and people felt America was still trying to act unilaterally and assuming that it was in that unipolar era. What America has got the ability to do is to lead multilateralism in a multipolar era. And that means consultation, it means working with your allies, it means building alliances, it means cooperating, and it means understanding that the world has changed over these last 30 years and is never going to go back to that single unipolar moment that we had after 1990. But, you know, I feel the same problem that identified elsewhere is also true of America. What President Trump did, he didn't say, I'm going to close down free speech and say, I think it's a terrible thing. What he said was, we're under threat and we've got to do everything in our power to force America first or these ideas onto the agenda. So he builds walls, he has exclusions, there is discrimination against certain groups of people, and that's justified in the national interest. And I think, again, America under Biden will come to terms with the fact, and this is why the alliance of democracies that he's proposing is important, that we've got to work with other countries over these next period of time, and to assume that we can just do everything we want is never going to be the right way forward again.
I'm just going to move to some questions inspired by comments from the audience. So I'm going to read one audience comment who says, speakers alluded to forms of leadership that are deteriorating democracy, namely nationalism, populism, and leaders who use democracy to be elected and then concentrate power. What is worse, that such leaders exist or that citizens vote for them? Laura, I'm going to start with you on this because you mentioned in your comments, in the hands of the strong man, you were the first person, I think, to mention this current pattern of challenge to democracy about strong leaders who are democratically elected but then centralize power. Do you see that as an immutable global trend, or are there solutions on the horizon? Go ahead.
Yes, the thing here is that we are in a kind of vicious cycle. People are, you know, they have expectations, they have needs. There are many different kind of uncertainties in their lives, so they are demanding responses. And at the same time, again, instead of bringing more in-depth solutions in trying to transform our institutions, what we are just is putting more power in the hands of one man. Because they are usually men, I have to say that too, no females. And of course, that is a very terrible way of responding to the challenges that democracies have right now. So here, basically, what I think we should do is try to go beyond the traditional institutions. For sure, we have to do something about improving the legitimacy of our political parties, our parliaments, and there is a space to do that. But at the same time, we should be willing to move forward. We can use digital technologies in our favor in order to open more spaces for people's participation so they can really have a voice. People, you know, look, people have discovered that there is public life between one election and the other, and they want to, you know, to use that space. And that means basically, again, bringing some new institutions in terms of participation, deliberation, and that is the correct route. This also means that the international community had to put democracy as one of its main concerns. It is very difficult to understand, for example, how in the case of Nicaragua, they continue receiving the support of all the international financial institutions. Those institutions are concerned about the macroeconomic indicators, but they are never concerned about what is happening in terms of human rights. So let's be serious. I mean, if we need to defend democracy, that means that the international institutions have to, to bring the issue into their agendas, not only the multilateral institutions, but also the kind of institutions which have the muscle, such as the financial institutions.
Laura and Ernesto Cedilia, could I ask you the same question? As you've heard there, there are means to tackle the threat posed to democracy by the strongman model of government. Do you think Laura has identified the right ones, and are there others?
Well, allow me to emphasize one or two basic ideas, and that is that we must not fall on, you know, in the game of attacking citizens for taking the wrong decisions. And this is not, of course, in any way in reference to what President Chinchilla said, but rather in the question that, as you presented it originally. Of course, there are underlying conditions that explain why people have fell back in recent years. And these members of the old regime have managed to come back and use democracy by means of demagoguery, by means of populism, and basically by means of lying to the people that they have the magic solutions to fix the situation that concerns citizens. So I don't think we should, at least at that point, blame citizens. Their sin may be that they believe these demagogues and say, okay, they are promising to change everything for the better for me and my family, and I will go for them. And then we must acknowledge that these people, these politicians, have been very skillful in using media to create a hardcore of followers who can be very militant to support them. But that's the reality of political competition. I think we have to address really what is underlying this problem. In the case of Latin America, what happened is that for a number of years, our economies, generally speaking, were growing. Our social indicators were making progress, and probably some people in our region declared victory too soon without recognizing, number one, that the process of reform was not really complete. And number two, that this bonanza that we saw in the first 15 years of the 21st century had as a very important factor propelling it, the commodity boom. And this commodity boom was, of course, walking or moving on the shoulders of China. However, our leaders were taking credit for that. Oh, look, thanks to the reforms that we did in the 90s and that we continue to do, but that was not the case, really. They were not continuing to do those reforms. We can deliver now higher economic growth and reductions in poverty, modest improvements in income distribution. When the commodity boom was over, what happened? People were in a state of disillusion. And then, you know, the demagogues came back and dressed up as Democrats, won power, and now they are systematically undermining democracy. So here, there are two scenarios. One is, I think the right one is to continue in the political arena, arguing, deliberating, discussing the basics of democracy with people, with the citizens. I think I would prefer that, and that democracy by itself solves this problem. And the other way, which is very sad, is that, well, in a few years, people would say, you know, we were wrong to support these kind of governments. We are paying the consequences, you know, and let's see whether by then we have some democracy to get rid of these, in a very democratic way, of these autocrats.
Thank you so much, Ernesto. Michael, can I ask you to perhaps pull together this section of the discussion? You heard Ernesto say, don't attack citizens for voting for demagogues. And I guess, again, in the United States, this is a theme amongst how to bring your own democracy back together. Please.
Well, Jamie, thank you for that question. Let me just go back to one point you describe what I'm saying about the United States as a blip. It's not a blip. It's a very serious issue here. So I'm not trying to sugarcoat that at all. But I very much agree with what Gordon Brown said about the importance of the United States leading, because I do see from where I sit, and maybe we've been quite critical of the U.S. administrations from time to time and of U.S. actions, but the reality is, if the United States does not lead or to try to lead in a constructive way, I don't see who is going to lead, and that kind of cedes the territory to autocrats. I mean, I think it's striking that in the hour or so that we've been talking, we haven't mentioned the word China or Russia. And from what I see at from Freedom House, you know, China has gone in the last 10 years from a country that was liberalizing, opening up, to a country that not only is further repressing its own people, but is also now exercising a great deal of more influence on the world stage, exporting surveillance technology to like-minded countries, undermining the rules-based order at certain UN institutions. I think while it's important to democracies have to deliver, democracies have to pay attention to themselves, but I also think there's a very, very serious problem around the world with growing authoritarianism, and to date, not really an effective response from democracies. So I just wanted to say that.
Michael, I'm sorry for misquoting you in the attempt to provoke debate. Let's move into a final section of the discussion about solutions, because so much of the Club de Madrid activity is focused on positive suggestions for finding solutions both around leadership and resilient institutions. So again, a question that's come in from the audience: how can we make democracy more appealing to citizens again and improve the trust in liberal democracy and democratic institutions? And this was raised earlier. Again, I think, Michael, you said that democracy was a supply problem and not a demand problem. And we've seen that, as you rightly said, in Sudan just in recent days. So I'm interested in ideas from the panel about how to engage voters again with the idea of democracy, but also any concrete examples of regions in the world, countries in the world, or indeed emerging leaders who you see as pointing the way forward. Let me start with you, Gordon Brown.
What I think Michael mentioned at the beginning, a number of movements across the world where people are prepared to stand up for human rights and for democratic process. And I see young people in places like Thailand and Nigeria, and perhaps surprisingly, these places that are standing up for change. Chile, of course, you've got this pressure for a convention for a new constitution. In the United Kingdom, we're talking about how we can reform our constitution so that power is seen by people to be closer to them and that they can feel that they've got more control over their future. When the Brexit referendum was fought in Britain, the successful slogan was "Bring back control." And there is a stronger sense of place now and people wanting decisions to be made closer to home. And I think our democracies have got to respect that. I was also influenced by what was said about optimism about the future. Because when I look around the world, I think Michael Ignatieff did a book on this, Touring the World, and he found that people had a far stronger sense of their own individual rights now, that people thought that they had rights and that they should be in a position to see them realized, but they had less of a conception that their rights depended on other people having rights as well. And so this is an educational process. People are no longer deferential in the way they were. They don't believe in the old hierarchies. They're not prepared to act as subordinates. They do have rights. But I think we've missed the connection that your rights depend on other people having rights as well. And I think we've got to give people hope. And I think one of the problems of the last few years is that we've gone through austerity, a global financial crisis. We've now got a climate change crisis. We've had pandemics. And I've got teenage sons, and they are not as optimistic about the future as I would expect young people to always want to be. And I think we've got to give them a message of hope that we are going to rebuild our democracies, that we're going to make a moral effort to tackle populism and nationalism and strong-arm dictatorships, that we're going to stand up for the Universal Declarations of Rights, and that we're going to deal with inequalities that cannot be justified. You know, there's a great moment when Martin Luther King is giving that famous speech in 1965 on civil rights. And his speech is not actually going very well, and it's probably far too technical. And he's giving a lot of detail without convincing the audience. And then someone sitting next to him, I think she was called Natalia Jackson, shouts out to him, "Martin, tell them about the dream." And suddenly Martin Luther King realized that he had to give people a vision of the future. He had to give people a sense of the world that could be, not just the world that was. And he, of course, "I have a dream, I have a dream, I have a dream," he said. And that is what people remember, and that's what captivates the audience. And I think it's giving people this sense that there is something worth fighting for, that the difference between what is and what can be is something that we can show people by the strength of our democratic values. And I think that could actually make a difference. So educational effort, and the Club of Madrid does specialize in this, is really important. You know, we've been through these terrible tragedies and lives have been destroyed, but we ought to be saying that despite all these tragedies, democracy is indestructible, and we must not allow it to be destroyed. And that while hearts have been broken during this last period when so many lives have been lost, there are certain things that are unbreakable, and that is our commitment to human rights and to democratic values. We've got to give people that sense that we believe in what we're doing, and we also have a vision of the future that is more democratic and where people's rights are properly safeguarded and guaranteed.
Thank you, Gordon Brown. Laura Cecilia, let me ask you the same question. And we've had a question in from the audience about current campaigns for human rights and democracy in Cuba, of course, an important example in your region, your part of the world. Perhaps you'd like to pick up on that and any other examples that you see on the horizon.
I would like to mention probably three ideas, actions that we should encourage in order to strengthen democracy ahead. The first is that according to a very recent analysis presented in Latin America, the last Latino barometer that was presented about 4 weeks ago, according to the data, education is the main factor shaping generations of Democrats in Latin America. And that is very powerful, because it means that not necessarily living in a democracy makes you a Democrat, but educating people on democratic values can really make a difference. So I think education should be part of the policies that we should try to emphasize. The secondly has to do with strengthening and protecting civic society organizations. Organized civil societies continue to be the last barrier against the autocratic drift. So we should continue, again, opening spaces to protect civil society, the press, etc., etc. And finally, let me say something about the female leadership, because I really think that there is something here that has to do with a kind of leadership. And probably that has to do with, that women tend to display a distinctive approach to power. It is a less kind of arrogant attitude, much more willing to listen and to conform policy with respect, with discipline, in trying to consult with different sectors. And, it's more kind of collaborative and attentive kind of leadership. I think that we should also encourage bringing more women, more young people into politics, in order to bring also more kind of democratic values and more tolerance into politics, which is something that we are really demanding right now.
Laura Cecilia, thanks very much. Ernesto Zedillo, would you like to pick up with your examples of positive examples around the world of where progress has been made, perhaps?
Well, forgive me to going back to my own region and thinking what lies ahead. I think what lies ahead is a very difficult situation, but that must be confronted. This undermining of democracy, accompanied by a very bad period of economic and social indicators performance. But I would say that the message for those who believe in democracy and that have real hope in Latin America should not be the way of following the tactics of the autocrats and the demagogues of lying or providing false promises to people. I think we have to start by recognizing that we have missed opportunities in the past very seriously to address real concerns of our citizens, because Latin America continues to be the region with worst income distribution in the world. Latin America has the worst citizen security problems in the world, and that speaks a lot of weak rule of law in our region. And notwithstanding the progress that we saw in the early years of the 21st century, Latin America continues to be one of the worst performers in terms of its economy. And I think that emerged very clearly last year when we were by far the worst, not only performer in the economy, but that was also associated, sadly, that we were among the worst performers in terms of dealing with the pandemic. And I think that speaks a lot about how we are. So we must start by saying, yes, our problems have solutions, right? But we must acknowledge that we have failed in the past, but this is not going to be solved by posing that problems can be solved magically. And there has been a repetition about what Winston Churchill said. And I think perhaps for me, the most important thing is that in his finest hour, he told the British people the truth. I can only offer you sweat, blood, and tears. I will not offer the blood, but I would say, yes, we have problems. This is the diagnosis. We are not going to overcome these promising magic solutions. We will need effort. We will need sweat, probably tears, but our problems can be overcome. And we must attack these problems simultaneously in all these three fronts so that we can escape the development trap in which Latin America continues to be trapped. And then I think democracy will deliver, because democracy must deliver to be sustainable for citizens.
Thank you, Ernesto Zedillo, and a very interesting contribution from the audience member saying that how can we take account of the fact that only one of the top 10 fastest growing economies in the world is considered a fully fledged democracy, being India, of course, and very relevant to your question about economic performance of Latin American countries. Again, Michael, if I may, I might just ask you to summarize this section. You know, Freedom House has a really good overview of both the bad and the good. And I wondered whether you might say a little about either regions or individual countries or individual leaders who you think are making a difference in the promulgation of democracy around the globe.
Well, let me make a couple points. Three quick examples that come to mind. I think first of all is Taiwan. Taiwan has been a remarkable democratic success story over the last 30 years, you know, basically moving from a country that was essentially a military dictatorship to one of the most vibrant democracies in the world, and a number of other Asian countries like that. South Korea would be another one. So I think countries like Taiwan give me a great deal of hope. I would also mention Sudan. I think Sudan has a very difficult week there, and I hope that it ends up turning around. But the truth is that 10 to 15 years ago, Sudan, I would never have imagined that Sudan would have a democratic opening, but a move to liberalization. The leader of the country was someone who had been wanted on war criminal charges by the International Criminal Court. And yet the ordinary people of Sudan, you know, rose up and basically helped precipitate his fall. And that also gives me a lot of hope. And then coming back to my own country, one point that I would also make is that, you know, we're a federal system. And so a lot of the focus around the world is on the dysfunction in Washington, which is, as we've talked about, Jamie, legitimate. But when you look around my country, there's been an incredible outpouring of civic activism around my country on issues ranging from voting reform, civil rights, civic education. Literally in the last 4 years, I can't keep up with the number of groups that have been formed to try to address those serious problems. And those journalists and others who look at what's happening on the state and city level also have seen a lot of interesting innovation happening there. So I think that hopefully we've seen in the past where some of the innovations in the states have come to Washington, and I hope that may happen in our country. I would say just return, Jamie, if I will, to the two issues that I mentioned at the beginning, journalism and corruption. I think those two issues are really important issues that democracies can band together to support and fight. I mean, not fight corruption, but also to support independent journalists. If independent journalism continues to attenuate, then it's going to be very hard for democracies to function. Because in the end, and I don't mean to be Pollyannish about that, journalists are independent, fact-based journalists are one really important guarantor of having a lively democracy.
Hear, hear, and amen to that from this moderator. We're into the final stretch now. Before I summarize, I'm just going to ask for a very quick final contribution from panel members, specifically actually on the response to COVID, which we probably haven't spent that much time in this panel on. But I guess the campaign for democracy has emerged from this incredibly difficult two-year period. And I wonder whether panel members have a sense that as we emerge and start to rebuild after COVID, that there's an opportunity in that for democracy to assert its ability to support, for example, effective healthcare, multilateral institutions that are making the difference around vaccination and so on. Do panel members see an opportunity on that? Could I ask you all maybe for a brief one-minute contribution? I'll start with you, Gordon Brown.
Well, there's a huge contrast between the great scientific achievement of the vaccine and the manufacturing of it, and the fact it's so unequally distributed around the world. And until we solve this problem of unequal distribution, we're going to have a two-track pandemic, and we're going to have discord across the world. So if only 1% are vaccinated in some countries, 5% in Africa, 2% in low-income countries, but 70% in the West, then this divide between the vaccine rich and the vaccine poor is not, of course, in the interest of those who are unvaccinated, but it's not in the interest of people in any country, because the disease will continue to spread and mutate, and it'll hit even the fully vaccinated later. So if we're going to learn and build from the success of finding a vaccine and being able to cure a disease, we're going to have to bridge this huge gap between the vaccine rich and vaccine poor, because I see huge amount of dissent. This is the biggest public policy failure, because we expect 5 million more people to die next year, and thousands, indeed hundreds of thousands of these deaths are avoidable if people were vaccinated. So we've got to do something about that first. And if we don't, then I do fear for the reaction of the public, who will feel that the international community, one group had the vaccine and was protected, and the other group was left to die. And that's just not right.
Thank you. Ernesto Zedillo, your thoughts as we re-emerge from COVID, an optimistic time?
Well, not yet, really. I think we must acknowledge that the pandemic was used, and again, I'm talking about my region, was used by some governments to reaffirm their worst autocratic an incompetent face. And this is not a saying, this is based objectively on very clear indicators. I was member of the independent panel for pandemic preparedness and response. And one of the things we did in that panel was to examine countries' performances. And I was very sad to discover how bad Latin America, with some exceptions, again, like Uruguay, like Costa Rica, on vaccination, Chile, how bad Latin America was doing in 2020, and actually how bad relative to others we are still doing in terms of vaccination. And this is not a problem of resources in Latin America, because many of these governments are spending a lot of money supposedly to respond to the pandemic or to do other things and are not applying those resources to vaccinate as well and as fast as they could do. I think the opportunity stems from showing people that these governments that promised to work for the people really worked against the people during the pandemic, and that this should be an element of consideration next time there is an election in a region.
Thank you very much. Laura Cincilia, for a quick final word from you.
Just to put some kind of positive comments, I will say that, at least in our region, we have to recognize that although the problems we are facing, democracy has been resilient in Latin America because we have gone through many different crises in the past, economic, social, political crisis, and democracy is still there. And now that we already started the new electoral cycle, it is about 30 months when most of the countries will change their governments through electoral processes, with the exception, of course, of Cuba, Nicaragua, and Venezuela. And what is interesting is that people are participating. They are eager to go to the polls. So I think that there we have the opportunity to promote the right kind of debate that Latin America needs in order for the people to make the better possible decision. But again, people participation and elections are, I will say, the main hope we have in Latin America.
Laura, thank you very much. Michael, just a brief final thought from you on the same subject.
Well, on the issue of the pandemic, the one thing that I would offer is that COVID-19 has been an unfortunate opportunity for many governments around the world to attack human rights. We've seen, you know, journalists in certain countries, you know, imprisoned, censored because of reporting on the situation. We've seen emergency measures that have been imposed by certain countries that we wonder whether they're going to outlast a pandemic. So I would just offer that COVID-19 has not been a positive development for human rights in the world. And I think that needs to be part of the discussion as we come out of the pandemic, hopefully.
Panel, thank you all very much. I'm going to attempt to summarize in 1 minute, an almost impossible job. We've heard a really striking set of thoughts to set the direction of travel for the rest of the summit. I guess it's fair to say that the panel are still, despite a very difficult 2 years for democracy, net optimistic, not least because, in Michael's phrase, this question of demand over supply. We still see parts of the world where activists, humanitarians and democrats of all types are still taking to the streets to demand their rights. And yet, at the same time, we've clearly emerged from a difficult period where institutions of all kinds which support democracy, particularly the courts, journalism, governments and governance more generally, have been under attack more than ever before. And that is because of a number of factors. Some have already mentioned the digital information age and social media, which is the subject of our next session, so I'm not going to volunteer too far into that. But also, it's clearly been a time of immense increasing inequality, between the haves and the have-nots, both in the COVID framework and more generally in terms of economic development. And these tensions, coupled with the weaknesses, the structural weaknesses that the panel have very smartly identified, give us the global landscape that we see today of democracy as an idea still valued by millions, prized by millions, and in a number of territories still actually becoming more firm and more embedded, and very good to hear some positive examples of that towards the end. But an idea that is still fragile in countries where we see that we had hoped that countries were traveling in the right direction now seem to be heading into reverse. Well, with that, I'd like to thank all of my panel for joining us today. So thank you, Gordon Brown, Ernesto Zedilio, Laura Chinchilla, and Michael Abramovich from the Freedom Center. Gordon Brown, before we go, you may know there's a Twitter account called We Rate Rooms that rates people's Zoom backdrops, and I'd just like to draw attention to the wonderful view from your window, which must be, it's Queen's Ferry in Scotland, isn't it?
We're looking out over the North Sea. It's been a real pleasure with Ernesto and Laura and Michael to talk with you today. And thank you for chairing this session.
Not at all. Thank you very much indeed for being on my panel today. So, following this enriching conversation, we will have a recess of 30 minutes before the next plenary. So the next plenary session will begin in 30 minutes' time at 5 p.m. Central European time. Thanks very much indeed.